So, maybe you may not interesting my don't follow my research. I mean, it is I answer some of the question. So how to use my lecture? I think it's interesting. I don't know, but it's in 2004, I was invited to give a lecture. At that time, I was retired from National Charlton University and go to some other place. And I was invited to give a talk. The talk is at Academic Seneca, which is a very high-level academic place. However, it is in physics department. And I give the lecture. I don't know how to present it, but I just present all these graphs. They have a lot of nice properties. So there are a lot of physicists asking me, how come do you know such graph has such big properties? I don't know. I really do not know how to answer their question because I cannot open my head. Can I? No. So, but maybe you can from your physics or chemistry point of view to start it. But I already told you somewhere I constructed. There is at least a three joint is a good way to construct it, right? Three joint is a good way to construct it. Cycle extension is a nice way to construct it, right? I do give you some construction. So maybe construction scheme is important because you don't know. So maybe you want to know what's going on. Maybe you want to, I don't know. That professor asking me how there are some nice property. Why? So how to generate such graph is important. So so let's play the puzzle again. It has a lot of interesting puzzle here. You see, you can also work on three star connect span connected on the bipartite graph. Here, the king want to rescue the mermaid, right? So this is a three star problem. The solution is you need to find the three internal disjoint paths from the beginning vertex to the end vertex. Okay. So this is called globally by three star connected graph. Every graph in category 2 has such a nice property. Don't ask me why, because I don't know. Coincidence. So suppose the wizard, the wizard, still ask to solve the problem. Ask the king to solve the problem. The king and the mermaid is in the same color. Can you solve it? Can you solve it? It's a nice problem. Maybe for kids, not for you. Really, it's really easy. Because the answer is no. Because just I show you, the parity is not good. Because odd even, the parity is not good. So, so that's my proof. So, it's easy, right? For kids, not for you. Okay. So, this one is not solvable. But, you know, maybe I'm a Christian. Yeah, I'm a Christian. So, I do pray every day. Okay? So, did you pray?
Yes,
I pray. I pray. So, Jesus is in some place. In some place. Then you solve the problem. Again, you find the three internal digital paths, except to not visit the place. Jesus standing. What I mean the puzzle? The puzzle is, the puzzle. So here is the two, actually there are two versions. Is Jesus sitting any vertex, any yellow vertex, or Jesus stand in some, not every, some yellow vertex. So there are two versions, right? So yeah, indeed there are two versions. However, I just say Jesus must stand in any. This is the version. Any version. So I call this problem is hyperglobulin by three star connected graph. Okay. Yeah, maybe you can think about what is the mathematical meaning, what is the physics meaning, what is the chemistry meaning. I don't know. You can think about it, but I don't know because my physics and the chemistry is very poor. Yeah. So. All graph in category 2 do have such properties. Well, don't ask me, I don't know. this one, I don't know why. Yeah, just created and using computer. Yeah. So, there are some interesting mathematics we can do. Is any globally 3-star graph, and any globally by 3-star connected graph is 184 tolerant Hamiltonian. Can you prove it? The proof is easy, yeah. You have already, here is the 84, and you try to find the three internal disjoint paths between these two vertices. Then the blue one, the blue line, plus the green one, plus the blue one is a Hamiltonian cycle. So it is a proof. You cannot say it. I have written a lot of math book. The book, one of the books I really enjoy is a book called Mathematics Without Number. Well, no, no proof without word. I mean, there's a book, Proof Without Word. This is the kind of proof without word, really. Yeah, it's proof without words, right? So, I want to prove the deletion of any two vertices is remain Hamiltonian if you are given a hyper by 3-star connected graph. It is 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian. And for any two vertices, any pair of vertices 40, it remain Hamiltonian. So I must delete these two vertices. Delete any two vertices. You cannot say why you pick these two. Any two, yeah, it is any. So I pick these two vertices. Pick these two vertices and I try to find the three internal disjoint spanning paths. Except this vertices. Except this one. This I mean this one is the king and mermaid and the god maybe. Maybe this yeah. Okay? So you find three internal disjoint paths through every vertice. And you see the brown one plus the blue one is a Hamiltonian cycle. Do not visit these two vertices. Is that easy? How about three join? How about three join? Can you jump these two graph? Is that globally star? If that is, if you join these two graph, this means you can have three. You can find the three internal disjoint paths between these two vertices of the same color. So, any three joint of this graph, any three joint of these two graph is not globally star. So this is something negative result. So let me give you some family of such nice graph. Here is I call D family, or D family. I think this easy. D family is of diameter n over 2, n is the number of vertices. Here, I call this maybe spider web networks. I call it spider because it is very spider web like. However, it is another honeycomb type. You see a lot of honeycomb. You make a honeycomb torus, something like that. The diameter is 1,000 here. The diameter is 150.
Yeah. Excuse me.
Yeah.
Can we draw any honeycomb, generalized honeycomb torus as such a net?
No. The generalized honeycomb torus, they don't have a cycle of four. All the generalized honeycomb torus, most of, I will show you that. I don't have honeycomb torus, but this one is this one, I call this one honeycomb torus 1, honeycomb 2, and honeycomb torus 3. And this is actually isomorphic to the honeycomb, generalized honeycomb torus, I mean n, the honeycomb torus n, tn is equal to isomorphic to generalized honeycomb n, 6n, 3n. Okay. Maybe remind me if that question maybe I can answer later. Yeah. Discuss later, yeah. So the diameter is around around the square root of n. Okay. And here is the Brother tree. I have introduced you day before yesterday, Christmas tree. I make two Christmas trees upside down, right? And join together. So I must give him a name. Brother trees, okay? I think the brother trees is perfect. It's interesting to point out that I think it's maybe I calculated wrong, but let me see. The brother tree is 11. The brother tree 11. The 11 brother tree has this number of vertices and of diameter 23, and the Christmas tree. The Christmas tree is only by two. Yeah, I don't know. I recalculated. Yes, it is only by two. However, the diameter of this one is 24. So it is a shorter diameter, right? So as I told you before, it is possible to lower the diameter if you try harder. Right? You try hard. Yeah. So, do we miss anything? Do we lost something? I think there's something we do lost. How to construct it? How to construct such graph? how to construct such graph. Because we have, day before yesterday, I have some construction, three joints. It's very good. The next is, the last lecture, I mean, all the negative result is three joints bad, three joints bad, three joints bad. The next question is, can we have a better construction? Yes, I have a better construction. I call A joint. This one, you see the difference. I have four A here, and here I have only three A here. Right? So you see the difference. It's very similar, but it's different. So I must show you how to get this picture. The idea is maybe, I think I pick an A here, A, CD, and I pick an H, AB. And we have A has a neighbor, X1, X2. B has a neighbor, Y1, Y2. C has neighbor, Z1, Z2. Z1, Z2. D has neighbor, W1, W2. So I draw it. No. I draw it. So I call it A joint. Okay? So this is a construction. And there is another way to construct it, but in the A-joint construction, I ate this one, I join this A to here to here, and here to D here. So this one, maybe I twisted some A's. Once I twist it, it is not bipartite, but it also has something interesting, really, really interesting. Let me tell you, the proof I forgot. Maybe not. No, I'm still working on it, but it must be done. It's roughly speaking, should be discussed more formal write down. So, roughly speaking? Basically speaking, once I join it, I guarantee this is 1P4 tolerant Hamiltonian. If you A join these two graphs, I guarantee you such graph will be 1P4 tolerant. You can delete any two vertices, remain Hamiltonian. It is remain 1H4 tolerant Hamiltonian label. And it is globally switched out. No problem. You have everything I have discussed. I should put the new graph insert this one into category B. Actually, roughly can insert back to category B. It's really. So that's the operation of A joint. What is this one? You see, this one, once I twist it, it is not bipartite graph. Well, the parity is missing. But this graph all should be put in category one. I mean, 1H4 tolerant Hamiltonian, one vertex four times, I mean one vertex four Hamiltonian, and the global switch star. Do you believe it? Okay. So that's another algebra. I call this, it is algebra. Maybe I call it algebra, I don't know. Yeah. So what I'm going to do, explain. I take any nice graph, very, very nice. So maybe I take a spiderweb network. I replace an age with a full cycle. What I mean, I replace with age cycle. I join an age, and I join with K33. I join with A33. It means I delete this vertex, it means I replace it with a full cycle. right? So once I replace this one, I can guarantee you this one is, it should be in category two, category B. If I draw this one, they have two different ways to join that A, but this one should be a twist, not a join. So I can prove this one is a nice graph. How to prove? If I want to prove this graph is the delete any vertex, any pair of vertices is Hamiltonian, it is globally by three star, whatever. The proof is easy. I shrink every four cycle here. Then I shrink some of the four cycle. Yeah, I get K33 as K33. Then I expand it, got it this. It is a similar story I could present to you in chapter 4. It is a similar story. Okay? You take any graph on category two. You pick any path of length three. Pick any I mean these two vertices is not so you subdivide these two vertices. Subdivide these three edges by inserted vertex and the extra vertices. You construct in this way. I can guarantee it is in category one. Why it is? Just the eight trees of Q3. Okay. I mean, take another example. I replace an eight with this one. Is equivalent to A join with Q3. So I have something like from this graph, I rejoin another layout to be here, then I ate something, then boom, a brother tree is born. That's maybe my start. Okay? So, for this one, this graph, it is a bipartite graph. This graph is not 1A4 tolerant Hamiltonian list. It is not. Why? You can play the beginning vertex, end vertex, and the cocked die here. Can you find any solution? I think you cannot find because I have already tried. Okay, this one is not 184 tolerant Hamiltonian list. This one is not hyper Hamiltonian list. This one is not hyper Hamiltonian list. This graph indicates it is not 1P4 tolerant Hamiltonian. 1P4 tolerant Hamiltonian. This is not 1P4 tolerant Hamiltonian. However, this graph is globally C star. You can pick any two vertices of different color. You can find three internal disjoint paths spanning that. No problem. So, but it is not definitely not hyper globally bisected star. How to prove it? It's easy. Because this one is not, because every hyper globally bisected star is 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian. Right? It's 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian. I have shown you, did I show you that? I think I have already shown that in here. Every 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian is every hyper globally bisected star connected is 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian. Okay, it's 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian, and I have told you that this graph is not 1p4 tolerant Hamiltonian. Suppose you delete these two vertices, these two vertices suppose a different color, you see? yellow, red, okay, so you cannot find a Hamiltonian cycle, so this one is not global shift star. So you can play, it still have some puzzle in like this. The puzzle is you play again, then maybe God will listen your, God definitely listen my prayer, and he will stand by a suitable red vertex and help me solve the problem. Okay? So still makes sense. Okay, this is the reference about where this come from, but this is not. So you mean the honeycomb problem? The honeycomb problem, the honeycomb problem is isomorphic to this one. Okay. You mean the generalized honeycomb torus? Once you draw the generalized honeycomb torus, maybe like. In generalized honeycomb torus, you don't have any cycle of any cycle of landfall. So the spider web network is different from generalized honeycomb torus. Yeah. So we have done some work prove the hyperglobalization star connected. For any events, generalized Peterson graph, and we have done some the generalized honeycomb torus M and zero, only zero means a rectangular honeycomb torus, and this one is a strongly globalization star if they have some constraint, but if you want to hyper globalization star. You have a stronger. Yeah. You can still a lot of family, you can work on that. Maybe, I don't know. Yeah. Maybe you can try some new family. Again, you should try. You can still working on. I mean, Yeah. Oh, I think already this is different. Yeah, I think that's any question about chapter 6? Any question about any other question?
No. No.
No. Yeah, there are more questions.
Pardon? I know. Okay. So maybe I still have 20 of 80, 50 minutes. I just start. What I mean the question is not the problem solved. You know, what is the next problem can be done? I have shown you there are a lot of questions can be done. So you see what I have already done a lot of material in this book, so the quite related. So what should be the next question in your book? Maybe I don't know. Yeah. So let me show you the question. Just a small initial. Yeah. Maybe I am a person who never grow up. Yeah. So maybe all my presentation like this fashion never grow up. Maybe 5 years old. Yeah, I think. Yeah. So, here is Shrek. You know, Shrek, very famous man, right? Here, this is Fiona, somewhere. Maybe in the hotel, yeah. Okay, donkey, dragon, okay? He must find the donkey, then dragon, then Fiona, then back home, right? This is the story, right? So I do find a solution. And you can play the puzzle again. Reallocate the location, right? Then it's still a puzzle. And is it solvable? Yes, it is solvable. So I mean, show you some interesting problem. Yes. Shall we say? Can you find some other graph with these properties? Yes. Definitely, these two graphs, no problem, I think, no big deal, right? No big deal, no. Can you find one? No. So what is the problem? The problem is, maybe, in 1997, there's some open problem, maybe. Someone proposed the problem, find such graph. So can you give one? Well, he say, this is, and can you find larger one? No, I cannot find any other. So when is the larger one? Find it. The larger one is actually the Hewitt graph. This is the famous Hewitt graph. It is. But when find it? 2008. Okay. Can you find more? Can you find more? I don't know. I will try to answer the question tomorrow. I think I should answer the question tomorrow. Yeah. Any question? Maybe earlier, but any question? I guess.
these are focused on the distance between the vertices and the finding the longest or shortest distance between, for example, two vertices. And I want to ask, do you have an algorithm for finding the distance between any two vertices very easily? Easy algorithm.
Oh, you mean algorithm?
Distance between any two vertices, maybe the longest or as the outer or.
I think the longest path, longest distance or shortest distance. The shortest distance may be traditional, maybe Dirac, maybe dichotomous distance. It's okay.
You know, because
what?
Because these distances are very useful to finding some graph indices, like linear indices, linear index, Hadikar, if I say the correct name, they worked on these kinds of indices of graph. And if there is an algorithm of finding the indices between the vertices, they should be so helpful for finding especially linear index for some.
Well, I think I don't know.
Graphs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And linear index is very important to in, especially for chemists, because of most of the molecular, especially non-molecular or chemistry, some molecular has the graph structure. As I remember the Euler, especially they are cubic. For example, cubic graph is kind of is one of them. For example, and the Wiener index, which is a summation of all the distances between all pairs, is very important for the chemists.
I know.
And I want to know that do you have.
But I didn't work on that problem. I never done Vienna distance. The yeah.
Or finding, for example, distance between.
No.
Sorry. Thank you.
Yeah.